Alright guys, here we are for the TNA Slammiversary 2013 review. Before I get started, I just want to quickly say I apologize for not doing a Raw, Impact, or even Slammiversary predictions video from this past week. I had a really busy week going, so I just didn't have time to make any videos. I apologize. That was not my intention at all. But today is Monday. It is like 4:30 here. I'm going to upload this now. This is a live experience review for the Slammiversary pay-per-view because I was there last night at the Agonis. It was a lot of fun. I'll get into that in a second. But I will be doing a Raw review. It'll probably just go up tomorrow so that way this video has time to like get out there and people can watch it. I'll also link this video in the Raw review because I want people to be able to see the Slammiversary review because I definitely want to do a review for this show because I was there. Anyway, let's get started. First match was the Triple Threat X Division match, Ultimate X, Chris Sabin, Kenny King, and Suicide. Really good match. I enjoyed the crap out of it. They did a bunch of triple team spots, which was so cool. Like, everybody worked together extremely well off each other. A couple of botches here and there, whatever. For the most part, it was really cool. They were trying innovative stuff, stuff I haven't seen ever. So, in my opinion, overall, it was a pretty cool match. Oh, wait. Okay, there we go. So that was a really cool match. I enjoyed that one. Chris Sabin's your new X Division champion. No problems with me. I love Chris Sabin, and this is the big comeback recovery victory for him. Sure, the ending was a little bit whatever, but it was kind of random. Kenny King just kind of fell off, but whatever. Sabin won. I'm happy. Hogan comes out, praises him, whatever. Which was cool. I'm glad Hulk Hogan came out and praised him. That's always good. If the Hulkster approves, you're in good shape in TNA, dude. Jack, my hands are all blown off from a radiator, but no, I'm just kidding. So then we had the six-man tag. The returning Jeff Hardy teams with Magnus and Samoa Joe to take on the Aces and Eights. Anderson, the awful Bischoff and Briscoe. I hate Bischoff, so I was shitting on him as he walked by. Our seats were actually wicked good because we were right near where Aces and Eights came out, very close to the ring. It was awesome. Our seats were absolutely great. So they came out and Hogan was just talking shit with them, and then the three baby faces come out, and it was actually a pretty solid match. It was good to see Jeff Hardy return live. That was always cool. And the match quality was solid, and the babyfaces go over. I'm not surprised. It made sense, actually, if anything, because Jeff Hardy was returning, and makes TNA look pretty dominant here, especially with the way the show ended. I was fine. A good six-man tag, and kept the crowd going. We were really already pumped up after the first match, kept us pumped for the second match. Of course, they killed the momentum by having Sam Shaw versus Jay Bradley after that. Jay Bradley goes over, and I still don't like him. I don't like Sam Shaw either. I don't even fucking remember the guy. This is a gut check match. Should go on Impact TV on Thursday nights, not ever on a pay-per-view, especially on Slammiversary. All right? Just saying right here and right now. I think that's a stupid idea. After that, we had the television title match, which was supposed to be Joseph Park versus D-Von, but D-Von and Knox, or Mike Knox, whatever, beat the crap out of him backstage. There was blood, so he saw his own blood. Abyss ends up coming out and winning the TV title after D-Von did, like, the classic, if Joseph Park doesn't get out here now, we win by forfeit, whatever, and then Abyss comes out. Ends up challenging him for the belt and winning it. Not surprised. It was a good moment. Got a good, very good reaction for Abyss. Everybody likes Abyss. He's a cool character. He always has been. I've always liked him. I liked him a lot more back in the early 2000s when he was so extreme. But I still like the guy. And it's Joseph Park, Abyss, whatever. I'm just waiting for the day when they actually are going to make it, just make it so that Joseph Park actually is Abyss. They aren't actually just brothers. Because I don't think they're going to be able to play this storyline off forever. Just saying. But we got a new TV champion in Abyss. And it was not really a good match. Didn't really go on for very long. But that doesn't matter. It was just about Abyss coming back and winning the belt and whatever. So again, Aces and Eights looks weak. Again, but like I said, the end of the show really changed my mind on how things were going. But again, I was fine with Abyss coming back and winning. Again, it made sense for the babyface to go over here. Not like D-Von was a great TV champion or anything. Jesus Christ, he didn't even defend the belt. Not his fault, I'm just saying, it's not like the run was any good, or dominant in any way, because he wasn't even, defending the belt, so, Yeah, so Abyss is back, and he's your new TV champ. Then we had the tag team match, the Fatal 4-Way Tag Match, which was really good overall. It was the Dirty Heels, Bad Influence, Chavo and Hernandez, and Gunner and Storm. Gunner and Storm ended up winning the belts off a super kick, or the last call super kick, into the torture rack, which I like for a submission for Gunner, because I always was a fan of Gunner. I think he's cool, and I think him using that makes a lot of sense. And they beat Aries and Rude West. First elimination was Bad Influence via DQ, and then Chavo and Hernandez kind of got caught in the wrong place at the wrong time, so to speak, with a roll-up from Aries. And then Rude and Aries were absolutely fantastic in this match. They performed extremely well. Crowd was really behind them the most. Kaz and Daniels did a good job, too, though, entertaining us, like always. Honestly, Chavo and Hernandez got the worst reaction overall. But I would have been most satisfied seeing either Rude and Aries win or even Bad Influence. But it's good to have a new team as the champion, so I really have no overall issues with Gunner and Storm winning it. So that was a solid match. I really enjoyed that one. So after that, we had the Knockouts match and the last Knockout standing, which was, like, you know, on paper, you expect it to just suck dick and be like, oh my god, it's a fucking Knockouts match. It ain't gonna be that good. But, I mean, except for the fact that there's boobs on your TV. And for me, live in front of me. Which is fine. The match ended up being a lot better than I would have expected. Terrence Arrell and Gail Kim actually did a really good job. The final spot was really cool because Terrence Arrell just, like, bulldogged her off the stage. Off the ramp. Onto the floor, which is a pretty like steep drop. So and from our seat, it looked really cool too. That was actually kind of a holy shit moment. The crowd was going holy shit multiple times. I mean, Gail, there was a chair wedged between the corner. Gail went straight into it. Gail threw Taryn onto the ramp. She went face first onto it. I mean, and she almost even went for a. I think she went for a pile driver on this. It, of course, didn't work out, but it was really cool. There were some pretty big spots. These two went at it really well. Terrence Arrell wins, no surprise. Babyface goes over. She's gorgeous. And, yeah, so no problems for me. I enjoyed the crap out of it. If anything, it was a lot better than the normal Knockouts match. I'll say that right the fuck now. So the match that followed was Kurt Angle, AJ Styles, one of the ones I was looking forward to the most. Was a really great match. Watching those two wrestle live is an honor. Those two have always had great chemistry. I personally really enjoyed this one. It was one of the ones I was looking forward to the most. Some great technical wrestling. AJ was doing his high-flying crap like always. He's un-fucking believable. He is one of a kind. Absolutely one of a kind. And a lot of good near falls. I will say the finish was weird. All of a sudden, just a strange pinning combination and Angle gets the win. I didn't really like that as the finish, in all honesty, but overall, the match was good. And I still didn't really like the Kurt Angle one either because they're trying to make AJ Styles feel like he's this new version of AJ and he's like aggressive and stronger and blah, 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 and whatever. Wouldn't you think he would win this match? That would make more sense, in my opinion. And I know why Kurt Angle went over. It's probably because tonight was the night he was inducted into the Hall of Fame. And not to say he didn't deserve it, because he so did. I'm just glad it wasn't Jeff fucking Jarrett, because I was ready to scream if it was going to be him. But it ended up being Kurt Angle, who they chose. And I thought that was a great choice. I thought Kurt Angle going into the Hall of Fame was absolutely what TNA should do, because the guy deserves it. He's an absolutely fantastic wrestler, one of the best of all time. I actually took a video of the announcement of Kurt Angle. I'll put it at the end of this video, just so you guys can see it. So it was a very good wrestling match between those two guys, as was expected. It was great, just didn't like the finish, and I still think AJ should have gone over. But overall, awesome match. I enjoyed the shit out of AJ's new theme, too. Very cool. And then the main event was Bully Ray and Sting. Went by very quickly, had some cool spots. I love the pile driver spots from Bully Ray. Those were fucking awesome, especially the one on the exposed ring. That was absolutely crazy. I also really liked the powerbomb through the table. That looked vicious. There were some heavy chair shots back and forth. Sting hit the Scorpion Death Drop. Bully hit the powerbomb. You know, it was very back and forth. There was, you know, but it was mainly Bully Ray. I will say, actually, I shouldn't say very back and forth, because it really wasn't. Bully Ray got in most of the offense, and then Aces and Eights came out. Sting fought them off for a while, but then there was just too much. The numbers game was enough to get Aces and Eights over. Now, I will say, I wouldn't think it would take all those guys to help, you know, Bully Ray win the belt, or retain the belt from Sting, a 54-year-old guy. But I will say that I do like their cohesiveness. They're a unit, they work together, and at the end of the day, they kept the prize they needed to keep, which was the world title. Devon can use his rematch clause against Abyss, whatever. But they kept the world title, which is the most important thing. So Aces and Eights is still looking strong at the end of the night. So I don't really have that much of an issue with it overall, like them losing the other two matches. I thought the other two losses made sense. This one made sense, too. The right guy went over. Sting's done. Being in the world title picture, he should be. I'm surprised because TNA loves Sting so much. I love Sting, too. He's one of my all-time favorites. But the right guy went over here. Bully Ray needed to win this match to prove why Aces and Eights is strong, why he is a world champion, and why they are going to continue to be the enemy force in TNA for the majority or probably the rest of 2013, or at least till Bound for Glory. Let me just say that. Because Hogan's going to win the belt, dude. Either way, it was a good match with some heavy spots, especially the pile driver spots. Those were fucking nasty. I thought that should have been the ending of the match. But Sting was a little bit of a super stinger and kicked out of him, which I don't mind. But I do think that that second pile driver should have been the finish. That's just my opinion. Overall, though, it was a good match and it was a great night. I enjoyed the crap out of that pay-per-view. It was so much fun to be there. So here's the video of Kurt Angle's induction into the Hall of Fame, just so you guys get to see it. It's only like a couple minutes, but, and it's really not the best quality ever, but there it is. So yeah, you guys can see that, and, I'll be doing the Raw review, like I said, tomorrow. It'll be late, but I'm doing that so that way people can see the Slammiversary review. I had a blast, great time. I recommend it for anybody. If it's ever in your area, TNA, go see it. A lot of fun. Absolutely great. Can't wait till they come back. So Slammiversary was an awesome show for me. No rating. I can't do it. I was there live, but I had a blast. It was a great time, great crowd, great friends. Absolutely fantastic. So overall, A-plus night for me. I enjoyed the shit out of it. Let me know what you guys thought if you did get to check out Slammiversary, though, down below. Until the Raw review, peace out.
And those of you who have been on the journey the whole time with us, we're celebrating every man and woman who's ever stepped into this ring and given it their all and made a TNA what we are. Together we have built TNA into a global success. And we couldn't have done it without all of you. This company has more determination and spirit than anything that I've ever seen. So tonight, like we did last year, we're going to be announcing
so
the second level that came into the TNA Hall of Fame. Last year, it was the
You guys are stupid!
And tonight, I would love to ask
Oh, shit!
TNA to come to
You're
the
not
stage
supposed to be able to!
Tonight's announcement.